Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 11. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Darkness veils his lovely face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Good morning. Welcome to Central. It's good to see everyone this morning. If you're visiting with us, you are truly our honored guest, and hope you come back each opportunity you may have. If you are visiting with us, there's a white card in the pew in front of you. If you can encourage you to fill one of those out and just leave it in the pew beside you, and we'll have somebody come pick those up at the end of services. So we'll get back to our worship service, and it's good to see everyone, and let's sing out. Psalm chapter 49, verse 15. But God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me.
When peace like a river attends, what ever
2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 17. But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, so that the message might be preached fully through me, and that all the Gentiles might hear. Also, I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion.
Once I stood.
Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this day that we could be here to hear thy word, sing praises to your name, lift up prayers unto you. We pray, Lord, for those that are not here with us today, whatever the reason may be. We pray, Father, for those that are suffering this time from the flu or COVID or pneumonia, Lord, we just ask that your blessings be upon them. Lift them up, heal them, Lord, as only you can. Father, we're thankful, Lord, for our elders who work tirelessly, Lord, to make things function here at the church. We appreciate them so much, Lord. Father, we thank you for David and his family, for the work that he does and the messages that he brings to us. We ask that you continue to be with him and bless him, Lord, at all times. Father, we thank you, Lord, for those that serve and protect us, Lord, the soldiers that are fighting for our freedom each and every day. We ask that you just be with them and bless them as well, Lord. Continue to be with our government, Lord, that is seems like it is failing, Lord, but we know that they can do better, and we pray, Lord, that they will, and turn this country around to where we can be the country that we should be. Father, we just ask that you continue to provide for all of us, Lord. We thank you. Thank you for all your blessings. We thank you most of all, Lord, for your Son, who was so willing to die for us, that we too may be able to join in heaven, Lord, and someday. Father, we just ask that you watch over this service, bless us, forgive us all when we sin. It's in your Son's holy and precious name that we pray. Amen.
Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He in my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ,
if you'd like to follow along, I want to look at a verse that was written by the Apostle Paul. Of course, he was just the human penman. The Holy Spirit was the divine penman. But he was talking to those at Corinth about the Lord's Supper. There had been a problem because a little earlier in chapter 10, he talked about them eating a common meal, and was making distinctions then when they would observe the Lord's Supper. And he said, don't you have houses in which to eat? You need to realize that when you come into the Lord's house, you're going to be partaking of the Lord's Supper. With that background, then he gives how to partake it. But look at verse number 28 and 29, please. But let a man examine himself. That's very important. And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself. Now watch carefully. Not discerning the Lord's body. So the purpose of the Lord's Supper, as we gather around, whether men serve or whether you serve yourself with the cup and bread that we have, it's a matter that we have to discern. Do I realize that this is representative of my Lord and Savior? His body, his blood. And if I can perceive that in my mind, now I can properly discern the Lord's body. But it is very much connected, this discerning and examining. It's not something that is a common meal. That's why children don't partake of it. But we as Christians understand what these elements represent. And that's what's so vitally important. Let's just give thanks for the bread. Heavenly Father, we thank thee so much for the supreme sacrifice that thou hast made in giving us this bread, that as we partake of it, it represents, it typifies the body of our Lord and Savior. May we always remember this, and may it always be that which is upon our heart and mind, that of whom we serve. In the name of Christ, we petition thee. Amen. Let's give thanks for the cup. Heavenly Father, we continue our thanks unto thee for the blessings of life, and particularly for this cup, this which represents the blood in which our Savior shed on the cross for all of mankind. As we examine ourselves, as we make the proper discernment, may we do so realizing that thou art God, and it was thy Son that came and died for us. Bless this cup, forgive us, in the name of Christ we ask. Amen. This concludes the Lord's Supper, but we'd like to take the opportunity for just a moment to talk about our contribution. Our contribution is that which we lay aside, and we do so because of our love, our appreciation of everything that Jesus Christ and God has done for us. And as we look around, particularly in this world, we have been truly blessed by God. Now, the principle of the Bible is that we are to give according to how we have been blessed. And admitting the blessings of God then represents the principle by which we give. And we're not giving to any particular person, we're giving it to the church, for which Christ is the head of, over which elders oversee and see that these funds are divided up. We're going to be talking about the budget in the very near future. But it is set up so that so much money is for this and for that. And so our collection is taken in and it's put in a general fund, and then we pay, take care of all of those obligations from that. So friends, what I'm asking all of us to do, including myself, let us look at our heart. Let us look at our lives. Let us look at all the things that God has blessed us with. Then let us give. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful unto thee for every blessing of life, for the physical blessings that thou hast provided that enables us to work and do the things that are being done, but especially for the spiritual things which we can lay by in store, and we can give, and we can give so that the church will prosper and that it will become widely known, not only here in Sarah Land, but throughout the world. Bless our offering this day, because it has come from our heart as we have examined ourselves. Forgive us, dear Lord. We ask in the name of Christ, and amen. As most of you know, there is a tray or a dish, whatever you want to call it, in the back and over here to my right. And as you leave, if you would just drop your contribution there, that would be greatly appreciated.
In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. If everyone else, please stand.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior.
This is different. There's this side. It's very full. That's different. Well, unexpected. I'm glad to see all of you. I had to run home in between Bible class and services this morning. Asher's got a little bit of a rash on him, so you may not want to get too close to him, but he's not ill. He's not sick. He's just, that just popped up last night. Don't know where it came from. And as I was coming back in, as we were pulling into the parking lot, I thought, wow, parking lot looks really good. I never get to see the parking lot during that time to see how many cars are here. And I thought, they're here to see me. And then I thought, they better not be. I hope that you're not here to see me, to hear me. It's my job to let you see Jesus, to help you to hear him. And that's what I hope that you are here to do. Next Sunday begins the spiritual enrichment series. I think it's being held at Regency this year, and I know that this was a program that was begun many years ago by Brother Billy Lambert and Brother V.P. Black while he was still living. I know he had a hand in getting that going, Brother David Sargent. And I'm speaking on that next week on Monday. And the theme for this year is overcoming. And that's a fantastic theme. It's something that as we as Christians go through our daily lives, we're facing all kinds of different difficulties. And we need to know and be assured that there is nothing that we can't overcome. With Jesus Christ, we can overcome anything that we face. And this is my lesson for that series. This is overcoming tests. I saw a survey in the Christian Chronicle. That's a newspaper out of Oklahoma Christian University. Now, I know we may not agree with everything that they stand for anymore or what they publish, but there's some useful information still in that publication. And they recently published a survey that they conducted where they got responses from 138 different ministers across the brotherhood, and they asked this question of those ministers. On a scale of 1 to 10, how severe is the shortage of preachers in churches of Christ? Now, I know you know, having just been through a preacher search, that there is a shortage of preachers within the brotherhood. Now, I've always said that, and that's what my father told me. There are always more pulpits than there are men looking to fill those pulpits. We're in a shortage. What surprised me was how these ministers responded to this question, how they responded to this survey. Out of those 138 that responded, 83 of them, that's about right at 60%, ranked this preacher crisis at least an 8 out of 10. That is, they either gave it an 8, a 9, or a 10 out of 10. Our preacher shortage in the brotherhood is so severe that preachers recognize it and say that it is one of the most important things that we're facing today. It certainly is a challenge and a test that the church is facing. Now, with that being said, I truly believe it's been God's providence that brought us here. And I am so thankful. And I'm gonna be talking more about this in the coming weeks, about how thankful I am that He has brought us here. What you already mean to us, and I hope the work that we can accomplish together. The church faces a challenge. It faces a test. We need men who are willing to preach, to teach, to make God's word known to the world and to our communities. But it is a challenge and it is a test that the church can overcome. Because we have the truth, because God is on our side, because we are a body, a brotherhood, we are united together in what we teach. Even this preacher shortage crisis is a test, is a challenge that the church can overcome. While we were at the Memphis School of Preaching, the director of the school at the time was Brother Bobby Liddell. And I know some of you know him and are familiar with him. And Brother Bobby Liddell, in teaching classes to us, one of his favorite lines to us preacher boys, you might say, was simply, "You can do it." And as I've gotten older and spent more time preaching, I realize that is some of the most profound advice that he could give, not just to preacher students in preaching school, but to any Christian. You can do it. I want us to look at John 16, verse 33. In this passage, Jesus is in an emotional state, we'll say. In chapter 11, Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. And it sets in action a sequence of events that can't be turned back. And Jesus is right here in the middle of it. He raises Lazarus from the dead, and word gets to Jerusalem. People come to see Lazarus. They come to see Jesus, knowing that he raised him from the dead. And in chapter 12, we have revealed to us that it was because of envy that the Pharisees and the scribes were seeking to work against Jesus, that they won't admit Him, they won't confess Him, and that they are opposing Him actively. They seek to put not only Jesus to death, but they're also seeking to put Lazarus back to death because of his testimony, because of what Jesus has done for him. That leads up to the Passover, the last week of Jesus' life. In chapter 17, Jesus will make this earnest prayer to God about his followers, on behalf of his followers, desiring for us to be unified in his name, to think the same things, believe the same things, to act the same way, to take care of one another. His prayer for unity is in John chapter 17. And he's right in the middle of that. When here in chapter 16 at the end, he's been speaking to them in parables, remember. In verse 29, as he says in verse 28, I came forth from the Father and am coming to the world again. I leave the world and go to the Father. Now they say to him, lo, now thou speakest plainly and speakest no proverb. Now we are sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God. Now we believe, now we understand. We understand what you're saying, what you've been telling us. He says, do you really? Verse 31. Do ye now believe? Behold, the hour cometh. Yea, is now come that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. When we face challenges, when we face tests in our lives, this is the attitude that we should have. Jesus says, you're going to be scattered from me. Some of you are going to deny me. Some of you are going to betray me. You're going to be like sheep who go astray. But I'm never alone. I'm never by myself. I always have God on my side. And then in verse 33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Let that be our attitude towards every challenge, every trial, every test that we face. I can overcome this because Jesus has overcome the world. I can overcome this because God is on my side. I'm going to have tribulation, but I can have peace in that tribulation. That's what I want to encourage you to believe this morning. That no matter what you face, no matter what you deal with in life, you can overcome it. So let's talk about some of the tests that we face in this life. There are different kinds of tests. First of all, there are tests of our physical bodies. There are physical tests that challenge us and our ability to live in and interact with the things and the people around us. Cancer is a word we don't want to hear, but we've all been touched by it. We've all been affected by it. We all have family members. Many of us personally have dealt with it or are dealing with it. That's a physical test. The physical affects the spiritual. There's no doubt. There's no denying that. What we go through physically can have an effect on our faith, can affect our spirituality, our relationship with Jesus Christ, and nothing more so than cancer. COVID affects everyone differently, and when we find out that's what we have, we don't know what to expect. It's a test. It's a physical test. Obesity, diabetes, arthritis. Becoming a preacher, I never realized how many people suffer with and how severe the effects of arthritis can be. These are physical tests that we deal with in our bodies. I'm glad to see Sister Margaret Moore here. She's dealing with some things. The Masseys are going through so much. I know so many of you are dealing with physical tests. You face these challenges daily. But I want you to know that you can overcome. Despite the pain and the suffering that you go through, your faith can remain strong in Jesus Christ. That's the message this morning. But there are also then those spiritual tests, tests of our faith. And we're going to look at some people this morning who dealt with these kinds of tests. But what I mean I'm not talking about temptations, and we're going to deal with that in just a moment. I believe there's a difference between tests of our faith and temptations. When I say tests of faith, I'm talking about things like VBS. If you've ever helped with, if you've ever helped to organize, plan, and conduct a vacation Bible school, it can be a test of your faith. It is not easy. It is exhausting. It is hard work. It will make you question if you want to be involved in that anymore. But if you love young people, if you love the Lord, if you love His Word, if you love spreading that cheer and that good news, VBS is worth the effort. But it can be a test of our faith. There have been several young men, and I'm always on the lookout, I suppose every preacher is, several young men that I've encouraged to think about entering into the ministry, becoming a preacher. These are men who have jobs, families, they're well settled, they're well established in their community, and they have a deep and personal faith. But that's a test of their faith, a challenge. Would you be willing to make the sacrifices, to do what's necessary to become a preacher? That's a test of a faith. It's not a temptation to sin, but it's a test of your faith. We studied last week in our Bible class the life of John Mark. And this morning we studied Demas, and we kind of contrasted them a little bit. Demas was the one about whom Paul said, "He hath forsaken me, having loved this present world." John Mark was a young man who began the first missionary journey with Paul, but after about two or three stops, he decided this isn't for me, and he turned back. Was that a sin for John Mark? I can't say that the Bible tells us that. It apparently was not, because John Mark remained faithful to God, continued to serve Him throughout his life, so that at the end of Paul's life, he wrote, "Bring Mark with me, for he is profitable to me." That mission trip that John Mark set out on was a test of his faith. He decided, or he learned in just that short amount of time, this isn't for me. We're not all suited for the same roles, the same jobs, the same work within the body of Christ. But we have to test ourselves to see where we best fit, what we're best suited to. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we're described as a body, and every organ in the body, every member of the body has a certain role. Well, we have to test ourselves to see where we fit best and what that role is supposed to be. Are we an eye? Are we a hand? Are we the feet? Where do we fit and where do we work best? We have to go through those tests of faith. Not temptations to sin, but tests of faith. It's a test of your faith to see whether you'll get up and come to Sunday school. And we need to be ready and prepared and determined that we're going to pass that faith. But it is a test of our faith. When young people finish high school and they get ready to leave home and go to college away from home, they're out on their own. Studies have told us that this is the time when our faith is tested the most. Now, we don't have to fail. I don't believe there's any test that we face that we cannot succeed in, that we cannot overcome. But those first few years at college, away from home, our faith is going to be tested like no other time. When it comes down to the two, physical tests and tests of faith, I think sometimes we would choose rather to have the physical tests, those physical challenges. I don't know, but both of them can affect us spiritually. There are different kinds of tests, physical tests, tests of faith, but then there are, I'm putting this in a different category, temptations. Temptations are a test not from God, but from Satan. Temptations are a test to sin. I want us to go to James chapter 1 and understand God is not interested in seeing us fail. Not any kind of test that we face. God is not interested. He does not take pleasure when we fail a test, whether it is a physical test or a spiritual test or a temptation. God's not interested in seeing us fail. He wants us to succeed. He wants us to overcome. He does not tempt us. When we face a temptation to sin, to say something we know we should not, to do something that is against or contrary to God's will, that does not come from God. He cannot tempt people to sin. It's not in His interests. He doesn't care to see us fail and sin. He doesn't tempt anyone. James chapter 1, beginning in verse 12, "Blessed is the man that endureth," or overcomes, "temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. God is tempting me. God wants me to fail." He says, don't let anyone say that. It's not the case. It can't be true. "For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." He's not interested in it. It's not in his nature. Sometimes we watch movies or we get our entertainment. I saw someone say this week. A lot of our entertainment is watching other people sin. And we need to be careful what we're taking in. But there's no joy in God when we fail. He doesn't get any pleasure out of seeing us sin. It doesn't interest him at all. He doesn't tempt men, neither can he be tempted with evil. But verse 14 says, "Every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." God's not interested in death. He doesn't want us to die. He wants us to live. He's not interested in tempting us, in seeing us fail. Sin leads to death, and God wants us to be with Him in eternity. God doesn't tempt us. We need to understand that. We face tests. We face challenges. We face temptations. God may test us. He may put our faith to the test, but He does not tempt us to sin. I want us to go next to 1 John chapter 2. If we are tempted when we're drawn away of our own lust, we need to understand the kinds of things we lust after. 1 John 2, verses 15 through 17. "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world." Those things don't come from God. The lusts of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, they don't come from God. They come from within our own hearts. They come from Satan. "The world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." In this whole book, John is trying to encourage Christians to believe, to be assured that we can overcome any challenge, any test, and any temptation. So first of all, we need to understand that about these tests. There are different kinds. There's physical tests, there's spiritual tests, tests of our faith, and then there are temptations to sin. Those do not come from God. We also need to understand this, that failing a test is not always a sin. Again, think of John Mark. He remained faithful, continued to work. He went with Barnabas. He didn't go with Paul anymore. Continued doing the work of God, even though he failed a test in a sense. Just when we find out that we're not cut out to be a preacher or an elder, we can still serve with all of our heart in the church. We may not have passed the test the way that we expected to, but we learn something. We realize something. There are some tests that you cannot fail. They're just simply to reveal something about your heart, to show you the truth. Some tests you cannot fail. I can remember taking in school the ASVAB. I know many of you did because many of you served in the military. The ASVAB, I never knew what this stood for. I had to look it up. The Armed Services Vocational Aptitude Battery. It's not a pass or fail kind of test. It just reveals your strengths and weaknesses. That's what these tests are meant to do. We can't fail them. We can overcome every test, but we have to understand that some of these tests are simply to reveal to us what our strengths and our weaknesses are. So with those thoughts in mind, let's look at some people who faced some tests in Scripture and how they overcame these things and what we can learn from them. Appreciate Patrick putting these passages out on our marquee out there. In Genesis chapter 2, Abraham has left his home, left his family. He is following God on faith. He doesn't know where he's going or where he's going to end up, but God has just told him to go, and he's going. Abraham never really comes to a place where he's settled, a place where he has something that he can call his own. He's a wanderer and a nomad his whole life, really, in truth. And in Genesis chapter 22 is where God, the King James says, tempts Abram. But of course, every other version will use tests or tried. God tests Abraham. He does. He's not called Abraham yet. Well, he is called Abraham, but God tests him. He doesn't tempt him to sin, but he tests him. Abraham, what are you going to do? Where is your faith? Do you trust me enough to go through with what I'm telling you to do? And you know what God asks Abraham to do? To take Isaac, his only son, the son of promise, the one through whom God is going to bless all nations of the earth. Abraham knows that Isaac is that one. He's the fulfillment of God's promises to him. God commands Abraham here to sacrifice Isaac, to take him up on the mountain, take a knife, take a wood, take a bundle of wood, and to offer him as an offering on an altar. And in Abraham's mind, he's done it. The book of Hebrews tells us that he counted that God was able to raise him up if he followed this command, if he trusted God, if he took his own son's life. God could raise him up. But God doesn't make Abraham go through with this. He was testing him. Instead of sacrificing Abraham, God provided a ram. There was one caught by its horns in the thicket. Abraham took that ram and offered it as a sacrifice to God. What we learn there is that in our tests, in our trials, in our challenges, when we trust God, He'll always provide those resources that we need to overcome. It's always there for us. May not be what we expected, but God provides them for us. Scripture is that way. It is that resource. When we turn to God's Word in those moments of weakness, in those tests, in those challenges, we can find words to help us to overcome. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13 is one of those verses that always helps me. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. There is always a way to overcome it. We learn that from Abraham. Joseph was a young man when his brothers sold him into slavery. They were jealous of him. He was his father's favorite. And through faithfulness to God, God elevated Joseph to the position of second in command in the most powerful nation in the world, second only to Pharaoh in Egypt. But he had to go through some tests and some challenges between his brothers selling him into slavery and his time as Pharaoh's right-hand man. In Genesis chapter 39, he is in service in the house of Potiphar. And Potiphar is a very important and wealthy person in Egypt. He has servants, and Joseph quickly is elevated to a position of head over Potiphar's household because of his wisdom and his faithfulness. Potiphar says, I don't even know what's in my own home, what's in my own possession. I trust Joseph with all of that. Potiphar's wife, of course, also noticed what a remarkable individual Joseph was, and she tempted him. She tested him. She tried him. She enticed him to lay with her, to be with her. But Joseph said, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? She tried physically to restrain him, to entice him. He was so unwilling to be with her. He was so set in doing God's will, he ran out without his cloak. Leaving it behind may have seemed like evidence that he had been there and that he was guilty. When she made false accusations, of course, he was thrown into prison. But Joseph had prepared himself. He overcame that test himself. by running away. And sometimes that's what we do. We're in a difficult situation. We're being tempted by our friends, our family, by someone to sin. Sometimes the best thing that we can do is run away. And that's okay. That doesn't mean that we're weak. It's not a sign of weakness. It means that we know this is a temptation and I have to get away, as far away from it as I possibly can. Ephesians 5 verse 11 says, "Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness." That means get as far away from them as possible. Sometimes we want to be friends with the world. We want people to think, well, there's really not much difference between you and me. But Ephesians 5:11 says, "Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them." And that's what we must do. We want to get as far away from the world, not live as close as we can to it. Sometimes overcoming a test means running as far away as we can. Esther was a young woman who had been taken from her life that she knew to live a life that none of us would willingly choose, I would think, in service to the king of a foreign nation. And Esther had a unique opportunity. Of course, Haman had plotted, and he was so jealous of Mordecai and of the Jews that he had plotted to trick the king into making it legal that all the Jews were slaughtered on a particular day, that they were killed, they were put to death. Esther, as a Jew in the king's court, had a unique opportunity. And Mordecai presses her and says, "You need to go before the king." She says, "If I go uninvited, he can have me put to death. That's a real possibility. That's something that could happen, and it's likely to happen." But in Esther chapter 4, verses 13 and 14, Mordecai commanded to Esther, "Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. If you don't do this, we're all going to be killed. There's no way around it. We're at an impasse. Our only hope is in you." Verse 14, "For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place, but thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed. And who knoweth whether thou art come into the kingdom for such a time as this?" She was being tested. And she passed that test. She overcame that test by doing something that no one had ever done before, going before the king uninvited. She had to have great courage. And what a remarkable victory that was for her and for the Jews. Because she acted, because she spoke up, because she was encouraged to go before the king, deliverance was provided for God's people. Sometimes that's what we have to do to overcome tests. We have to be encouraged. We are encouraged by our fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We're encouraged by studying and reading those examples of these men and women who had this courage in Scripture. But sometimes that courage is what we have in those times where we're tested. And then, of course, our Lord. Jesus was tested like no one else ever has been. To face scourging and crucifixion, denial and betrayal, when he had within his power the ability to prevent it all, to put an end to it, to say, "I'm not going to do this," and yet to allow himself to suffer these things. There were tests all along the way. We think about the temptations in Matthew chapter 4 when the devil came to him and tempted him in all those ways that John lists in 1 John chapter 2. And we think about his interaction with Satan in the wilderness during that time that he was fasting, after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And we think, well, that's the only time Jesus was ever tempted. But it wasn't. Jesus was tempted in all points like as we, yet without sin. Jesus was tempted many other times in his life, but he never gave in to them. Here in John chapter 12, as we mentioned, he's raised Lazarus from the dead. Persecution is beginning. The pressure is mounting on Jesus at this time.
And he says, beginning in verse 24, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone, but if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." He's speaking of himself, what has to happen to him. He knows what's coming. "He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor." But he says this in verse 27, this is the moment. He knows what's been happening, and he knows what's about to happen. He says, "Now is my soul troubled. But what am I going to do about it? What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour." That's what we would do. And many times that's all we can do. It's appropriate for us to say those things. "Father, save me from this hour. Provide deliverance. I can't do it. Father, I need your help." That's the way David prayed in many of the Psalms. But Jesus had come to this hour for this purpose. He knew what was happening. He knew what was about to happen. And he was going willingly in that direction. "Father, save me from this hour." Is that what I should say? But he says, "But for this cause came I unto this hour." He was willing to make the sacrifice. He was willing to continue on this path, to suffer that pain and that excruciating torture, that agony that he endured, both on the cross and as he was scourged. What we learn here is that sometimes overcoming the tests in life, especially the spiritual tests, especially those temptations, sometimes overcoming those tests means having to look death square in the eye. That's what those churches, the seven churches of Asia, were facing, that Jesus addresses in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. To every one of those seven churches, he gives his warning. He says, "I know these are the things that are going on in your congregation. I know these are the things you're dealing with. And you need to act. You need to do something about them." But he ends his address to every one of those seven churches by saying this: "To him that overcometh." He says that to all seven of those churches. What that reveals to us is that Jesus knows they can overcome. They can deal with these problems. They can face these tests. But it's going to be difficult. In fact, in verse 10, in Revelation 2, verse 10, he says, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life." That means even if it does cost you your life, even if it does come to the point of death where you have to look death in the eye, we have to be willing to say, like Paul did in Philippians 1, verse 21, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Sometimes overcoming those tests means we have to really deal with our own mortality. We're going to die. We might as well do it faithfully to the Lord, standing for what we believe in. There are different kinds of tests. There are different ways that we can deal with those tests. But we have to know that we can overcome every test. In fact, really, overcoming these tests simply most times comes down to our own attitude, our own heart, our own faith in God. We need to have that same attitude that Caleb had. Joshua and Caleb were the only two spies of the 12 that were sent into the promised land that came back with a report that said, "We can do this. We're ready." In fact, Numbers chapter 13, verse 30, Caleb says, "Let us go up at once, for we are well able to overcome it." The other 10 said, "No, we're like grasshoppers in the eyes of those people. They will defeat us. We can't take this land." And for their unfaithfulness, the children of Israel had to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. Let us be like Caleb and look at every test and every challenge in our life by saying, "We are well able to overcome it." John 16, verse 33, "Be of good courage. I have overcome the world." Tests are going to come in our life. How will you deal with them? How will you face them? Jesus has given us an example. He has showed us how to deal with these tests. And this morning, I want to test your faith. Are you a child of God? Are you a faithful child of God? If you realize You've never obeyed the gospel, but you should have. At some point in your life up to this moment, your faith should be tested right now. This is the time where you should make that choice. Are you going to rise up? Are you going to live faithfully to God? Are you ready to become His child, to serve in His kingdom, to be a member of His body? It's the greatest decision you'll ever make. The blessings far outweigh the difficulties, the tests, and the challenges. And I invite you this morning, if you've never made that decision, to make that choice today based upon your faith, repent of your sins, and live your life wholehearted towards God. You can be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ to have your sins washed away this morning. If you have done that, but you recognize there are tests that you're facing in your life that you're failing, that you are giving in to, those temptations. You know there's sin in your life. When you're a Christian, you need to repent of those things. Confess. We can pray together. You can live a pure life from this moment forward. But you have to be dedicated to overcoming these tests with God's help. If we can help you in any way this morning, we invite you and we encourage you. Come forward. Make it known as we stand and sing this song to encourage you.
God sent His Son. Empty.
And the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith.
I care not today what the morrow may bring, in shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth over everything, and all of my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding.
Let's pray. Kindly, Heavenly Father, we're thankful for another day today that we can come hear a word from our book. We're thankful for the blessing that David brought to us today. We're thankful for all the blessings that you have given to us. We ask you now that you would dismiss us with thy love, forgive us of our sins. In Christ we pray. Amen.